Hey, what's up guys? Victor here with Individual Investor. This is a follow-up to my video on EBITDA, where we'll discuss enterprise multiple or enterprise value to EBITDA ratio. To keep things consistent, I will continue to use Facebook's 10K report as we explore the uses of EBITDA. The enterprise multiple is a valuation ratio that you can use in combination with the price to earnings ratio in order to have a better understanding of the valuation of the company. And just like the PE ratio, the lower the enterprise multiple, the better. Something worth mentioning as well is that EV to EBITDA is one of the ratios that Dr. Burry likes to use when screening for stocks, as he explained in his MSN Money articles. Now, you might think that if you were to acquire an entire company, the theoretical price you would pay is the price of all of its shares or the market capitalization, which is in part true. However, if you were to acquire an entire company, you will also have to carry its debt as well. But you have the cash, cash equivalents, and any other liquid instruments that you can use to offset that debt. So, having said that, the enterprise value, or EV, is equal to the market capitalization plus the total debt minus any cash and cash equivalents. Let's put everything into practice now and calculate the enterprise multiple for Facebook in the year 2020 using Facebook's 10K report. So here I have a Google sheet where we're gonna keep all the items organized in order to calculate the enterprise value and the EBITDA. And here we have Facebook's 10K form. Now, the first thing we need is the market capitalization for the year 2020. I just went ahead and found it on companiesmarketcap.com. And we can see here that for Facebook, in the year 2020, the market cap was $778 billion. So let me put that in. Okay, the next item is the total debt. The total debt that can be found in the balance sheet. So if we go to the financial statements and then consolidated balance sheets under liabilities, well, you will actually see that under liabilities there is no mention or no explicit mention of any debt or long-term debt for Facebook. So what I did was I actually went to I have here in a separate tab, the same 10K form, but I went to one of the notes here, note 11, and they actually state here that, if you read here the last sentence, that as of December 31st, 2020, we had no outstanding long-term debt, which is fine. Facebook is in a great financial position. No long-term debt, great. However, if we go back to the balance sheet, even though they don't have long-term debt, there's something here that we need to add, and that is the operating lease liabilities, the current one, and also the operating lease liability, the non-current lease liabilities. Actually, the operating lease liabilities are some form of debt, so we have to add those as part of the total debt for Facebook. So let's see, for the operating lease liability current, we have roughly $1 billion. So that will be 1.023 plus, and here we have the operating lease non-current, that's 9.6 billion dollars. So 9.631. Perfect. So we have a total debt of $10.65 billion. Now, for cash and cash equivalent, that's very easy. If we scroll up here under assets, we have cash and cash equivalents. We have a total of $17 billion. Okay, $17.576 billion plus. Here they have actually a bunch of marketable securities, okay, 44 billion in marketable securities. These are also considered a, since they're liquid, they can also be added as a cash equivalent, if you will. Any shares or bonds that you can sell very quickly that are liquid should be considered as well as a cash equivalent. So we're gonna add that. We're gonna add these marketable securities as well. So that's 44.378. Perfect, so we have here $61.95 billion in cash and cash equivalents. So to avoid confusion and to make sure we're doing things right, I actually here have the Facebook's page on morningstar.com where we can actually verify that our numbers are correct. So you can see here that under financials for Facebook, if we look at the year 2020, we can see that the total debt was indeed $10.65 billion, just like the number we calculated from the 10K report. And also we can see here that the cash and cash equivalents for 2020 was also $61.95 billion, just like the number we calculated from the 10K report. So we're happy with that. And now the enterprise value will be equal to the market capitalization, okay, plus the debt minus the cash and cash equivalents. So there we go. We have an enterprise value or EV of $726 billion. Now, next, we have to calculate our EBITDA. So the first thing we need is the operating income. Okay, let's go back to the 10K form. And the operating income can be found under the income statement. So here we have the consolidated statements of income. Let's click on that. And here we have the operating income or income from operations. That's $32.6 billion for 2020. So let's add that here. Okay, now we need to add also the depreciation and amortization, and that's from the statement of cash flows. So let's go back to the table of contents, financial statements, and then statements of cash flows. And here we have for the year 2020, depreciation, depreciation and amortization, okay, and that's $6.862 billion. So that's again $6.682 billion. It's actually 862. All right, pretty straightforward. Our EBITDA would be the operating income plus the depreciation and amortization. And there we go. We have an EBITDA of $39.533 billion. And now, finally, our EV to EBITDA ratio would be the enterprise value divided by EBITDA. And that gives us a total of 18.38. Perfect. Hopefully that made sense. Now, your next question might be, well, how can I use the enterprise multiple? Well, one use case is actually when you're dealing with negative earnings or a negative EPS. As you might know, the PE ratio only works with positive EPS. So if you have negative earnings, there isn't really much you can do with the PE ratio, so you can use the EV to EBITDA ratio instead. Another use case is when comparing companies in the same sector or industry that have different degrees of leverage or capital structure. The PE ratio only considers price relative to earnings, so it doesn't include the leverage or capital structure. However, since the enterprise multiple includes debt and cash equivalents, it helps paint a more complete picture of the overall valuation of the company. Finally, as a rule of thumb, companies with EV to EBITDA ratios of 10 or below are considered undervalued. However, it is very important that you dig in and understand the reasons for the undervaluation, and that you also compare the enterprise multiples with the industry averages as well. Okay, that's all I have for now, guys. If this video was useful, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. And also stay tuned, because in my next video, I will cover EBITDA margin. Thanks for joining, and I'll see you next time.